previously in the complete creation.
The sediments it was carrying are no longer being swept by the flow and are dropped. The flowing water acts just like a continuously advancing conveyor belt. Hello and welcome back to part 15 of this exhaustive series looking at the creation-evolution debate. Still looking at geology, as that was the original weapon fashioned against the Bible and the inspiration for Charles Darwin to pen his infamous book on the origin of species. In the last part, we were looking at a strange sedimentary formation called crossbeds, of which the anti-creationists argue are former desert sand dunes, now fossilized. Because these huge formations of crossbeds are in the middle of rock layers around the world that we creationists would contend are flood deposits, these skeptics argue that this is evidence that the rock record cannot be from a global flood, but rather deep time, millions to billions of years. But we looked at these copious fossil footprints found in the Coconino Sandstone of Grand Canyon, a thick rock formation anti-creationists have adamantly claimed are desert dunes. But these trails of fossil footprints have several unusual features that all perfectly match the scenario of being formed underwater and not a dry desert. Even experiments with live animals showed the exact same features. But the desert dune advocates also point to other trails of fossil footprints found in the Coconino Sandstone, like scorpion tracks and spider tracks. Now, clearly, if we're finding such trails of fossilized desert creatures alongside the other footprints, it would lend credence to the idea that these were actually desert dunes and not formed underwater, wouldn't it? Well, actually, you can hardly call that proof that these deposits are desert dunes. For example, let's assume that the fossilized scorpion tracks really are from scorpions. Remember the fossilized scorpion I mentioned that was found in the sedimentary layers at Joggins, Nova Scotia? No one is claiming the Joggins formation was a former desert, especially when that fossilized scorpion was found alongside the fossilized remains of various fishes and clams and the fossilized trails of footprints from horseshoe crabs. Secondly, my friend Barry Hornby in Arizona kindly went out into his backyard desert and found some scorpions for this demonstration. As can be seen here, scorpions are negatively buoyant. They sink in water. And, as he demonstrated here, they can survive for hours to potentially days underwater. So, fossilized scorpion tracks, or even if we were to find a fossilized scorpion body in the Coconino Sandstone, does not determine that the Coconino was desert deposits. Notice that this does not take into account the possibility that these fossil trackways are misidentified due to deep time assumptions imposed upon the rocks, and that these may actually be fossil footprints of something like the Eurypterids, a creature colloquially called the sea scorpion. We'll ignore the possibility of misidentification to favor the argument of the deep time advocates, and assume that the trails of fossil footprints are indeed from scorpions. Now, here are some trails made by a scorpion in sand that my fellow researcher, David Lyons, and myself obtained, so you can have a comparison to the fossil footprints in question. Now, you can see that the impressions of the feet are quite deep, and significantly, there is a tail drag. As L.F. Brady noted in 1947, while studying the alleged scorpion trails in Coconino Sandstone, the trails often had no tail drag preserved, and as you can see, even the footprints were different. But because Brady and everybody else is going by the status quo that the Coconino Sandstone is fossilized desert dunes, the interpretation never crossed their mind that perhaps the scorpions were being buoyed up in water while making the trails. Furthermore, with regards to the alleged fossil spider tracks, I have a slab of Coconino Sandstone right here, and you can see the dimpled impressions in question. No one has positively identified the creature that made these tracks. It is assumed it is a spider, as it appears to be a creature with eight legs, with pointy ends for feet. However, seeing as how the evidence for the Coconino Sandstones actually being formed underwater is overwhelming, I would suggest that these are actually the tracks of a sea spider. Eight legs with pointy ends. It's negatively buoyant and so could walk on sand deposits being formed underwater. Leaving all of this fascinating topic aside, one would think that the best way to build your case demonstrating that the massive crossbed formations were desert dunes would be to compare them to modern desert dunes. But when you do, you quickly see why the deep time advocates do not make any comparisons to modern desert dunes. Here's a desert dune just outside of Roswell, New Mexico, that somebody kindly cut through with a bulldozer. You can see laminations in the sand layers. Now, while the laminations are sloped like crossbeds, that's where the similarities end. The laminations follow the curvature of the dune on both sides. So in other words, you have sloped sedimentary deposits, but the slopes are found in both directions opposing each other. If you head on over to White Sands, New Mexico, you see clear and dramatic crossbeds all over the place. But the crossbedded layers are different than the sand dunes being formed today. The crossbedded layers are the original white sands, and they have been weakly cemented together, presumably by water action. As that original white sand cement disintegrates back into loose sand, that loose sand is blown into dramatic desert dunes, which do not have crossbeds. So in other words, the modern desert winds are not producing crossbeds, they are destroying them. The original crossbedded and cemented layers were laid down by water and are now decomposing into sand dunes and not producing crossbeds. You can go there and observe this action for yourself. The present cannot be the key to the past, because present-day processes are destroying the past, not reproducing it. Furthermore, while you're there, take a look around. When we talk about deserts and desert sand dunes, most people do not realize just how much plant matter there is in deserts. I mean, just look at it. So now, if we're going to invoke the present being the key to the past, well, here's a modern day example of desert dunes. Where are all the fossil plants in the alleged fossil sand dunes like at Zion National Park? Or the Coconino Sandstones of Grand Canyon? The plants are gone. Might I suggest that these alleged fossil sand dunes fail the comparisons to modern day desert dunes in every way? In fact, the whole claim that the Coconino Sandstones were desert dunes was thoroughly and completely destroyed back in multiple papers and poster sessions starting in 2009 at the Geological Society of America's annual meeting, when Cheung et al. Presented poster sessions detailing their studies of the Coconino Sandstones. Now, while the sand grains from desert dunes have all of their sharp corners rounded from being rubbed against each other in the wind, the sand grains in the Coconino were mostly non-rounded. And the sandstones contained dolomite, ooids, and chert, all of which are made in water. When Cheung and team first presented their poster session at the GSA, countless practicing geologists saw the evidence and candidly remarked that everything the textbooks had said about the Coconino Sandstones was dead wrong. It was creation science researchers who uncovered the truth, and those creationary researchers even admitted how surprised they were by their own results. It overturned everything that had been taught about the Coconino Sandstones for decades. Those same researchers also examined these pipes of Coconino Sandstone, which you can see if you take a hike down the Bright Angel Trail in Grand Canyon. You can examine these for yourself. So here you've got the white Coconino Sandstone deposited on top of the very red hermit shale. So basically the hermit shale cracked, and when the Coconino Sandstone was laid down, some of the Coconino sands poured into these cracks in the hermit shale. Now, it has been presumed that the cracks were desiccation cracks. In other words, cracks that formed when the hermit shales dried out. Whitmore and Strom studied these alleged desiccation cracks from 30 different locations in Grand Canyon and observed at least 6 different very good reasons why those cracks in the hermit shales were not from drying out. Orientation of the cracks, the shape of the cracks, lines of flow within the sandstones indicate that the cracks were formed while everything was wet, probably underwater. But what I want to point out here is the purity of the sandstone that has flowed into the cracks. Let's ask some questions of the deep time advocates. How long was it before the hermit shale sat there before it was buried by the Coconino Sandstone? Now, according to evolutionary ages assigned to those rock layers, the Coconino Sandstone is about 275 million years old, whereas the hermit shales are about 285 million years old. Stop right there. Now, that doesn't sound like much of a difference, but that's 10 million years. How much does the terrain around you change within historical times? Remember back to part 3 of this series when we looked at Ellicott's map of the Niagara Falls region, compiled in 1790, and compared the differences in terrain to modern times. So just a little over 200 years. What changes will happen to the terrain around you in, say, 1,000 years? Rivers will carve gullies and canyons, change the terrain a lot. A lot of vegetation and animals have come and gone. Tectonic activity will even change the hills. And that's all in 1,000 years. So now envision 10,000 of those 1,000-year time spans. Well, look at the contact between the Coconino and the Hermit Shale. Where's all the erosion of 10 million years? It's a perfectly flat contact, except for those pipes, which we will take a closer look at. Surely there would have been vegetation that had grown on the surface of the Hermit Shale in that time? I mean, surely vegetation would have grown on the surface of the Hermit Shales in 20 years, let alone 1,000 or 10,000 times 1,000 years. Yet, those cracks in the Hermit Shale, alleged to have been caused when the Hermit Shale dried up, remained open and clear for how many years? Until the Coconino Sandstone, which we can now definitively say was deposited by massive amounts of water, washed in and filled those cracks. There is no evidence of time between when the Hermit Shales were laid down and the Coconino washed in and buried it all. We have literally dozens of reasons to conclude that it was all laid down in rapid succession by water on the scale of a worldwide flood. So, speaking of absence of time, let's also come back to the Coconino Sandstone footprints for a minute. Compare these two fossil footprints to each other. The displaced mud, pushed back as the creature walked forward. You can see the dimples made in the sand by the toes of the creature's foot. They really are identical in every way. Those of you watching who have studied the Coconino footprints, do you see anything unusual about these tracks? Do you see anything that would indicate to you that they were not fossil footprints? Do you see anything that would indicate to you that they were not footprints from the Coconino Sandstone? So let's take a quick look at a cross-section view of Grand Canyon with this model at the Akron Fossils and Science Center in Akron, Ohio. Do stop in and visit if you get the chance. So here you can see we've cut through the canyon to look at the different layers of rock. And I have their evolutionary assigned ages that for a multitude of reasons I think are bogus. And those are approximate ages now. Approximate 300 million years, give or take a week or two. We're going to go over these ages with a fine-tooth comb in the next few lectures when we deal with dating methods. Now, here's the Coconino Sandstone way up here. And the U.S. Park Service has assigned that rock an age of 275 million years old. Now, interestingly, back in 2007, Vance Nelson, the owner of Canada's largest traveling creation museum and the author of the excellent Untold Secrets of Planet Earth book series, spotted these fossil tracks at Blue Beach, Nova Scotia, Canada. They are identical to some of the tracks found in the Coconino Sandstone. Now, those rocks at Blue Beach are claimed to be around 355 million evolutionary years old. Coming back to Grand Canyon, you can see the alleged ages of the rock layers. So according to the evolutionary dogma, the rocks at Blue Beach would be around, you know, the same age as the Redwall limestone. Getting older and older down here at what is called the Great Unconformity. And at the Great Unconformity, you have a series of tilted sedimentary and lava layers. This group of layers is called the Grand Canyon Supergroup. Apparently, these layers were originally laid down horizontally, There's that principle of original horizontality first proposed by Nicholas Steno. These layers were presumably laid down on these granitic basement rocks, which are identical to the Canadian Shield rocks. And you can see these basement rocks as you go down into the inner canyon. At some point, there was tectonic activity which tilted this group of layers, and some event sheared off all of these layers and laid down the main sequence of horizontal layers. So that shearing event was astonishingly powerful, and this layer right here, the Shinumo quartzite, is composed of quartzite. We talked about quartzite in a previous lecture. It is an incredibly hard and tough compressed sandstone. Well, car-sized chunks of the Shinumo quartzite are found in the upper layers, like the Bright Angel Shale. The incredibly tenacious Dr. Walter T. Brown documents one such car-sized block in his book, In the Beginning, which you can see for yourself on his website, creationscience.com. Notice the block is suspended in the Bright Angel Shales, which are above the Tapete sandstone layer, which is the layer deposited on top of the cut, the unconformity. The Bright Angel Shale is claimed to have been laid down some 10 million years after the Tapete sandstone. Hold up. Are you evolutionary geologists trying to tell me that somehow that car-sized block of Shinumo quartzite was somehow suspended up there for tens of millions of years until the Bright Angel Shale was slowly and gradually laid down to support and suspend it? That's nonsense, and you know it. Those plentiful quartzite blocks are powerful evidence that the Bright Angel Shale and the Tapete sandstone were laid down at the same time, which would have been the same event that sheared off the Grand Canyon supergroup. But I digress. I want to focus on this layer right here, the Tapete sandstone. Now, you can walk on this layer and examine what I'm about to show you for yourself. And may I remind all of you that destroying fossil tracks in Grand Canyon is against U.S. federal law. If you can, take a hike on down the Bright Angel Trail, you can get to Tonto Point. You are standing on a ledge of Tapete's sandstone. And follow that layer back and you will see copious fossil footprints. Originally discovered by geologist John Mackay. You can even see trails of footprints in a right-left sequence. Those footprints are identical to some of the tracks found in the Coconino sandstone. But the Tapete sandstone is allegedly 525 million evolutionary years old. Let's jump back to those tracks Vance Nelson spotted at Blue Beach in Nova Scotia. The tracks found here are supposed to be the very first amphibians to appear on Earth through evolution. That's one of the reasons Blue Beach and Joggins became so famous. Yet, here we are finding footprints of probably what are probably amphibians in the Tapete sandstone that is claimed by evolutionists to have been laid down 200 million years before the first amphibians even evolved. Remember what we touched on briefly before. If we have organisms which were not supposed to have evolved until way up here on the evolutionary column, and we find them way down here, hundreds of millions of years before they were supposed to have evolved, this would falsify the entire fossil sequence of the evolution myth. So here we have evidence of amphibians, which were not supposed to have appeared any lower than about here on the evolution column, appearing way down here, long before their very ancestors from whom they were alleged to have evolved. This is a complete falsification of major predictions of evolution. Evolution would dictate no footprints or skeletons being found in rocks that old, for the simple reason that these creatures would not yet have evolved. This falsifies both the theory of evolution and these assigned ages, as they are codependent on each other, yet in clear conflict with each other. End of story. This collapses the entire evolutionary column. This evidence does, however, fit nicely with the young Earth creation model, which has no problem with these footprints found in the lower layers, because, according to the Bible, all of life on Earth was created within a literal week, only a few thousand years ago, and that these sedimentary layers were all formed during the destruction of life and land itself by a global flood only a few thousand years ago. We will come back and revisit these footprints when we discuss alleged intermediate fossils like Tiktaalik and the numerous failed predictions of the evolution myth.
Coming up in the next Complete Creation.
The assigned ages have changed over time, getting older and older. This can be seen in the popular press. For example, in 1905, T-Rex was alleged to be 8 million years old. But T-Rex must have been aged in dog years or something, because by 1927, he was 30 million years old. By the time 1941 had rolled around, he was allegedly 100 million years old.
You can catch the entire series in a variety of ways. You can watch the show online at www.completecreation.org or www.genesisweek.com. You can also purchase the Complete Creation series in full high definition on Blu-ray or video on demand at completecreation.org. Or support the Miracle Channel with a monthly tax-deductible donation and access the entire Complete Creation series in high definition through Corco, Miracle Channel's video on demand service. We need your support to keep this program on the air, so please pray for us. And if you wish to financially support the program, Canadians can make a tax-deductible donation to CORE Ottawa, Canada North, Post Office Box 72075, Ottawa, Ontario, Canada, K2K2P4. Or you can make a donation via PayPal online at ianjuby.org/donations. And thank you for your support.